Dear God, we praise you and thank you for this day and for the opportunity that we have to lead your people in worship. I am grateful for all those who invest of their time and their energy and their heart to be a part of this experience. And we just pray this morning, God, that you will be honored and glorified through all of our efforts here. And I pray that you would speak to us in powerful ways, and that even through mediums such as social media, that your word and your promises will come through loudly and clearly, and you will receive the honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
right. Good morning, everybody. How's everybody doing? I can hear it's coming through the camera. I can hear it. It's loud. It's awesome. That's awesome. It is such a great day, just like every day, to be together, to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So let's all take a minute. Let's take a few minutes here and stand up. Again, let's raise our hands. Let's be so open and so willing and so excited to worship our Lord and Savior today. Here we go. King of love, my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever. Streams of living water flow, my ransomed soul he leadeth, and where the verdant pastures grow, with food celestial feeding. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul on the mountain high, or in the valley low, the king of earth. Shepherd is, the king of love, my shepherd is. Lost and foolish off I strayed, but yet in love he sought me, and on his shoulder gently lay, and home rejoicing brought me. And death's dark veil I fear no ill, with thee, dear Lord, beside me. Thy rod and staff, my comfort still, thy cross before to guide me. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul on the mountain high, or in the valley low, the king of love, my shepherd is. King of love, my shepherd is. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Never king of love, my shepherd is. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul on the mountain high, or in the valley low, the king of love, my shepherd is. The king of love, my shepherd is. So through all the length of day, goodness faileth never. Good shepherd, may I sing your praise within your house forever. Within your house forever. Amen. Amen. I have no words to say, don't know what I should pray. God, I need you. God, I need you. Oh Lord, my faith is tired, and tears fill up my eyes. But I will trust you. I will trust you. Whatever comes my way, you have taught me to say, Amen. Let your kingdom come, Amen. Let your will be done, and through the everlasting to everlasting, from everlasting to everlasting, from everlasting to everlasting, from everlasting to
your kingdom will come here on the earth as it is in heaven. And as we bow for prayer this morning, we are mindful of all those whose lives have been disrupted, those who have lost loved ones, those who are dealing with sickness and pain, and those who are disconcerted and disheartened by the state of the world. We'll lift to you David and Dawn Bordenkircher and the death of his mother, and as they continue to care for Dawn's mother in their home, continually pour out your Holy Spirit upon them and comfort them. We pray that you would comfort Linda Cox in the death of her mother, and Pam Kenner in the death of her Aunt Janice. To all these families and those unmentioned that are still struggling with death, please grant your peace and comfort. We pray healing upon Michael Bond as he recuperates back at home from a hospital stay, and for Nevin Thomas as he recuperates from his heart procedure. Norma Lawless, who's Janice Dorsowitz's mom, who's back at Dominion after a fall. Michelle Robinson, as she continues to go through testing, as she continues with not feeling well. And Frances Carson, as she recuperates from being in the hospital this week. And God, on this Martin Luther King Jr. weekend, we are praying for your peace to be in our nation. We pray for Inauguration Week that you will pervade the hearts and the minds of the people of our country, and that you would help us to be peacemakers, and that you would help us to know that the only true peace can be found in you. And I pray this morning for all those who are on the front lines of the COVID-19 battle. And God, we continue to pray for an alleviation of this dreaded illness, which has compromised our lives for almost a year now. I just pray, God, that you would come and perform a miracle, that you would return us to normalcy, but that we would never be the same again, that you would instill in us the ability and the desire to be better people as a result of going through trials and tribulations. Pray for those who our public servants, for our military and those who put their lives on the line every single day for the safety of our community. I pray that you would protect them and give them your peace. God, I pray for our congregation that you would bring revival to us, that we would be a great role model and a shining example of what it means to be the church, that you would help us to be even more faithful and rededicate our hearts and our lives to serving you and to reaching out in love and concern to a broken humanity. Pray that you would come and meet us here at this point of our greatest need. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon Pastor David as he brings the message to us this morning. Help him to be assured of your presence and your power. And may you be honored and glorified through our lives. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen.
Generosity, that means like sharing. Yeah, sharing means caring. But we're also going to talk about something else. We're going to talk about extravagant generosity. Oh, yeah. What's that mean? That means going beyond things. Giving way, it's like just to the nth degree, too much. Kind of like you. You're too much. So today, in order for us to do this, Sally, I thought what I'd do is, hey, you know what? I got some gum. Yeah, you like gum, don't you? So I got some gum here, and why don't you and me show boys and girls what that means by sharing, okay? Let's do this. Okay, Sally, we got some gum right here, okay? And we're going to talk about generosity, okay? And we're going to use this as an example, okay? Now let's say I came up to you and I said, hey, Sally, how you doing today? And you blah, blah, blah. And I said, can I have some gum? And you'd say, sure. And then you'd offer me some gum, and I'd take some gum. That's being generous, okay? And you go, here, take what you want. Now, but today we want to talk about extravagant generosity. That means giving more than you have. And so if I came up to you and I said, can I have some gum? And you said, sure, I'd take some. And then let's say I come up to you again, say, hey, can I have some gum? And you say, sure, and then I take some. And then let's say I come up to you again, I say, can I have some gum? And you say, what? No, you don't say you don't have any. Why would you say you don't have any? The red's your favorite. Okay, I'll do it. Let me do it my way. Okay, let's say I have three pieces of gum, and you come up to me and you say, hey, Doug, you got any gum? I go, sure, here. That's right, I gave you all my gum. Well, I gave it to you freely because you wanted it. And see, that's what we're called on as Christians, to be generous, but not be just generous, but be extraordinarily generous, to give all that we have, okay? So when we give, we should try to give everything that we have, because we're giving to the body of Christ, and we're giving so that everybody will succeed. How's that? Well, Sally, wasn't that great? Yeah, we learned how to be extravagant with our generosity. And so when you're out there and you're doing things in the world, always give more than what is expected of you. Yeah, like giving 110%. But you want to give all to whatever, because when we give all, we're basically giving all to Christ. And that's what we should do. Okay? Do you have any questions? You do. Well, okay, you can have one piece of gum now. Don't stick it under the table. Okay, kids, we'll see you next time. Bye.
I'm so thankful for disciples who give of their time and their talents, like Doug and Sally, on sharing a video with us today for the children. But also thank God for the praise team that give of their time and their talents to God so that we might worship passionately each and every time we gather for worship. Do you know what kind of church people are looking to become a part of? Bishop Robert Snazy, in his book, Five Practices of Fruitful Congregations, say that people are looking for churches that are shaped and sustained by the qualities of radical hospitality, passionate worship, intentional faith development, risk-taking mission and service, and extravagant generosity. These characteristics make churches contagious and help churches fulfill their mission and ministry to make disciples. For the next 5 weeks, we will consider these qualities and consider how we can do them even in the time that we find ourselves living in. These practices are not only important for churches or congregation, but they're important for disciples as well. And today we'll begin by looking at extravagant generosity. And let's look what Paul says in 2 Corinthians in the 9th chapter, verses 6 through 15. Would you hear these words? The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, but for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way, for your great generosity will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ and by the generosity of your sharing with them and with others. While they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given you, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. As I was preparing for today, I asked myself a question, how have I seen Crossville First United Methodist being generous? And I want to brag on you for a few minutes. Since I have arrived here, my first visit here, I experienced the generosity of time of the Staff Parish Relations Committee and the staff as they welcomed me here to help me to learn about you and your ministry here. And you provided lodging for me and meals for me in my visit. And when my family moved, you were generous to provide movers to help me to move into the parsonage, a wonderful parsonage that you provide for us. And you provided meals for us on that day that we moved in, and we ate on those meals for days afterwards, so we were sustained in our unpacking. And wow, the pounding you gave us. Now, if you're not familiar with church poundings, don't worry. It's not the kind of pounding you may be expecting. No one was hurt in this pounding. This was a display of radical hospitality and generosity, extravagant generosity, by the giving of food, canned goods, and household products and paper products to help us to settle in. And I have to say that you gave so many paper products, we're still using them at this time. Now, this pounding comes from an old tradition in the church that when a new pastor arrives to a church, the church members would give them 5 pounds of flour, or 5 pounds of cornmeal, 5 pounds of bacon, 5 pounds of sugar, etc., to help them to provide for them and for the pastor and the family as they settled in. Your generosity has been shown by the outpouring of your support for the Thanksgiving meal we had for those who wouldn't otherwise be able to have a special Thanksgiving meal. And you're generous in your giving to the Good Neighbor Ministry so that we can help those in need to pay bills such as utility and rent. And your generous support of the Martin Elementary partnership, especially through the Christmas Angel Tree program, you gave without considering gifts to, or give, considering yourself to give gifts to those children who had need. And I want to thank you for your generous outpouring to the staff Christmas bonuses. It was amazing. And I especially want to thank you, and I thank God for your generosity that goes beyond the walls of this church. And that's important for disciples, but I want to say to you that giving to God through your church, through your tithes and offerings, is just as important or more important. And it's not just about paying the bills. And I'll get to why that is so important for disciples in a moment. And these I've mentioned are just some of the ways that you're generous, and I probably missed some, and I know I have, and during the pandemic, we were probably limited in some of the ways that you have been generous in the past. So I ask, what is extravagant generosity? And how does extravagant generosity help disciples to grow in faith? And how does it help churches continue their ministry of making disciples, especially when we're limited by a pandemic, by the pandemic and all that it brings upon us? And we need to think about how we can continue to do things, these things, such as extravagant generosity during this time. In our passage today, Paul is encouraging the church in Corinth to continue to be generous in their giving to an offering, benevolence offering, to help the church in Judea, to help those who are affected by a drought, a terrible drought. And this passage contains the often used, God loves a cheerful giver. Someone shared with me after the first service that God loves a hilarious giver, and I think that could be a translation for that passage as well, because God sometimes gives hilariously and extravagantly to us. Now, chapter 9 in this letter is the second chapter that Paul has talked about this offering, and he spoke of it in the 8th chapter, and I wonder why he continues to to speak of it even more here. Maybe their interest in the offering has waned over time, because at this point it hasn't been delivered to Jerusalem, but Paul's sending persons to take it and can send it. And I know from my experience working in disaster response and disaster relief that especially when media stops covering the disaster of and the relief efforts, that the offerings to that ministry go down. And isn't that true for us? We may lose interest in church or what the church is doing, or we get mad and we may hold on to our offerings. That's not what God calls us to. And Paul's reminding the people in Corinth of God's wonderful grace that God has poured out upon them to get them to where they are. You know, we're not worthy of God's grace, but God pours it out abundantly upon us. We are all recipients of God's grace. And I know we tend to fall into the thought that everything that we have, we've gained on our own by our own hands. But Paul is reminding them and us that all that we have comes from God. And this is in line with biblical teachings, especially in the Old Testament. This undeserving grace that we receive deserves a response. It moves us to a response. The response is that the grace that from God finds its fruition when it flows through us. We are not to hold on to this wonderful grace that God has given to us. We are to share it with others. And Paul, as he encouraged the Corinthians, encourages us to give freely. Allow that grace to flow through us. Give it without strings attached. As we know, when gifts come with strings, they're not a true gift. As Luther thought, and we believe and tend to proclaim, that we are a part of the priesthood of all believers, and meaning that we share in the ministry of Christ. And we are called to take a part in this ministry. Paul expected the Corinthians to share in his ministry and to share in the ministry of this offering out of their abundance. And our giving or our not giving out of our abundance, even when our abundance seems so small, is a test, as Paul says, a test of our responsiveness to God's giving of God's grace to us who are undeserving. And we're not only called by Paul to give, but we are called by our Lord Jesus Christ to grow into extravagant generosity, to give as our God has given to us. The spiritual gift of generosity, and it is a spiritual gift, is you can find generosity in Paul's list of the gifts of the Spirit, is a gift that is available to all. And it's one that is worthy for disciples to grow into, as it reflects the nature of God's giving. And it is part of our Christian journey, as a part of God's call to make a difference in our world. Giving connects us to the body of Christ, to the church. And it helps the church fulfill its ministry and mission of making disciples. So how does generosity through God's church help make disciples? Well, I think the most important thing, that it provides opportunities for discipleship, for growing in discipleship, for growing in faith. And it provides places like this wonderful facility that we have for that to take place, for people to grow in their discipleship. It allows for disciples to practice their faith in many ways, especially through radical hospitality and passionate worship and intentional faith development and risk-taking mission and service, and provides opportunities for extravagant generosity. It allows the church to be the church, even in this difficult time we find ourselves in. And this has been true since the early church, and it was true with the early Methodists. If your parents and grandparents were a part of a church, they were a part of this. And they believed that it was true that they were called to grow in their generosity. Our parents and our grandparents tithed to the church, or they gave proportionately. And this is in line with the practice of our Jewish and early Christian ancestors. And this goes all the way back to Abraham, who gave a tenth of the spoils of war to God. Some of you were taught to tithe or give proportionally to the church to help the church fulfill its ministry. I was taught to give and to give generously. But it really, this lesson to tithe didn't really hit home to me until I became a minister. I was thinking when I became a minister, if I'm going to teach and preach about giving the tithe, that I needed to do it myself. And I asked my mother about the tithe, and she told me the story of my grandfather, who would, when he received his pay, he would come home and sit down at his roll-top desk, and the first thing he did out of his pay was count out the money for his tithe and other gifts to the church. And he had a special cubby in that desk that he would place that offering until Sunday, where he would take it to church. This was a model for my mother, and it became a model for me in my tithing. And if I was going to grow in my generosity, I would need to do the tithe. Do it first thing off the top. So when I got my pay, instead of writing my checks for my bills and for things that I wanted or needed, I would write down either in my check register or write the check to the church. And I have to admit that when I first started giving proportionally, I probably wasn't even giving 3%. But I made tithing my goal. And it took trust. It takes trust in God to give generously and to give extravagantly. Had to pray to God to help me to get there, and it took me 2 or 3 years to get there. And God doesn't want you to struggle financially, but we need to respond to what God has given to us. And I have to admit that my finances got better and better as it forced me to budget what I had, what God had given to me, so that I could share generously. And I strive now to align my giving with God's teachings, our Lord's teachings on money and wealth. And I have to admit that I haven't gotten there 100% yet. Bishop Robert Snazy in Five Practices for Fruitful Congregations says, people who give generously to the church do so because they genuinely desire to make a positive difference for the purposes of Christ, and because they want to align their lives with a higher purpose. Disciples want to genuinely desire to make a positive difference. He goes on to say that they give in response to the Spirit's urging, and this brings a satisfaction to their soul, a soul-sustaining satisfaction. They disciples give because they love God, and they love God's church. So they love Christ's church, and they want to grow in their love of their neighbors. Disciples who are growing in their faith, that are growing in their generosity. They do so so they can grow in their love of God and their love of God's church and their love of neighbors. With all the five practices, extravagant generosity attracts others. When churches desire to follow Jesus and grow in these characteristics, others want to be a part of it. Now, earlier I was bragging on your generosity, and I'm learning how generous this congregation is and its history of generosity. But I want you to know there's always room to grow. There's room to grow in our spiritual life, and part of that is growing in our generosity. You and others have extravagantly generous to give for this building so that people can come and hear the good news of Jesus Christ being proclaimed, and they can have a place to come and to grow intentionally in their faith and participate in mission and service and to worship passionately. And yes, we're living in a time of change for the church. We've changed this, right, and especially right now, we're online only for worship. But even when we're in person, that's changed. We can't always do what we have wanted to do. But that doesn't change our mission and our ministry to make disciples of Jesus Christ. And it doesn't change the fact that we are to share God's love with others. And you have shown in this time that you can adjust and you can adapt. And this was shown through the Thanksgiving meal, which originally was invite people into the church to share in this meal to a takeout and delivery meal. That shows that you can adapt and change to continue to do what, to be a part of what God is doing in the world. And you've shown that you can continue to be extravagantly generous in your response to needs during this pandemic. With the Martin Elementary Angel Tree, you were extravagantly generous to brighten some children's lives at Christmas. Now we must prayerfully consider how God is calling Crossville First United Methodist Church to be extravagantly generous moving forward. And I ask you to consider what you are giving. How are you giving proportionately? An easy way to figure that is to take what you give and divide it by your income. And it'll give you the percentage of what you're giving. But I want you to consider, prayerfully consider, to give proportionally, with the goal being to tithe, to give 10%. How will we continue to be extravagantly generous to be a part of what God, Christ is doing in our world? And Christ is still moving even in this time of pandemic. What is it that Christ wants us to do to show our love of God and to show our love of neighbor? It's important that we continue to mature in Christ. And maturity and extravagant generosity is the fruit of that maturation in Christ. Bishop Swayze says, "It is the result of God's sanctifying grace that molds our hearts and changes our priorities and how we act." It also supports the other four practices to help our congregation fulfill its ministry to make disciples. Jesus Christ, to make disciples of Jesus Christ in fruitful ways that open the message of Christ love for us to more and more people, not only now but for future generations, to make a difference not only in our lives as disciples, to make a difference in the lives of people in our community, of others, to help us to grow in these practices and in fruitful living. We will offer during Wednesdays in Lent class on the five practices of fruitful living, which are the same five practices of fruitful congregations. We hope to offer that with in-person class, but we will at least do an online version of that, depending on the active number of cases of COVID. I thank God for the generations that have gone before us, who have provided generously so that we have a place to proclaim the good news of Jesus and to grow intentionally in our faith and to worship our God passionately. And I pray that we can continue to be a part of this so others can do so as well. And I pray that we can become extravagantly generous. And Paul tells us our generosity brings a lot of thanksgiving to our God. May we be a part of that. And as Paul said at the end of this passage, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
These pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed, but not forsaken, I've been set free. The sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. Oh, I can see the
this morning for participating in the worship, and anytime that you join us on social media, we ask that you would make a comment so that we will know that you're here worshiping virtually with us as we provide these services in the name of Jesus. At the conclusion of this worship service, we will always have slides of both the mailing address and the website information that you can continue to give your tithes and offerings to, and we want to thank you so much for being faithful and generous in your gifts to continue the ministry of Jesus Christ in this place. We wanted to announce to all of our youth, 7th through 12th grades, that there will be a Zoom meeting tonight at 5 to 6, so don't forget that. I want to let you know that one example that we continue to attempt to be extravagantly generous, as we have done the past few years, we will be participating in the Super Bowl of Caring cans of soup drive, and we invite you to bring those by the church during office hours, Monday through Thursday, 8 to 5, and just press the buzzer on the back door or the one that's closest to the office, and then you can be buzzed in and you can drop your cans of soup there for the Super Bowl of Caring, and we're grateful to you for your generosity in doing so. Well, thank you for being here this morning and for watching service online, and we have been reminded this morning very eloquently by Pastor David of what it means to be a faithful disciple of Jesus and what it means to have the practices of a fruitful congregation, and one of those is being extravagantly generous. As we leave this morning, help us contemplate on how we can be more extravagant in our generosity toward God and toward one another and toward the Church of Jesus Christ. Will you receive the benediction, please? As you go this morning, may you go in the love of God, the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Go into the world and express God's extravagant generosity to a world that is broken and in need of Jesus Christ and His church. Will you go in that assurance in the name of Christ?